Okay, it's 7:02. I will call to order the Community and Business Relations Committee. We have all members present, as well as Village Manager Ewald. Village Manager Ewald, if you could go through for us the agenda item, please.
Happy to. Maybe the easiest thing to do is just to start on page one. In summary, this document puts together the workflow of how we process through initiatives and different tasks that we have. So in the first page, you see, the purpose is to define the tools and the processes to provide a framework so that all village stakeholders can operate. It defines work plans that are essentially a project management tool used by village staff and administration to document annual operations, as well as assign tasks and initiatives. Work plans were born out of two places. First, that we anticipate staff will change over time. And so it's a helpful way to understand what's going on within the scope of a position so that if there is transition, we're set up with a framework of which to transition the tasks. Later, they became also a way to allocate and accommodate for various initiatives that fell into our work scope in addition to the core services that are prioritized first. We then talk about the village initiatives that involve activities beyond core services. Typically, they're multidisciplinary in approach and have a staff leader, possible consulting services, aspects of community engagement, board and committee staff meeting, project funding, beyond standard operations that may be approved through a department head, through our purchasing policy. That was a brief summary of page one. Could I stop?
Any questions? Page one? Okay.
Page two identifies the annual initiative timeline. One of the reasons why I'm speaking to this now in December is that I'd like some consensus in terms of how we proceed and provide that direction for the annual initiative timeline for 2025. You'll see it starts with the first deadline in January 31, running through March 5th, April 30th, June, August, and November. And all of those follow the cycle of how we also put together our fiscal plans. In the village, we never try to do all of them at one time, but spread them out so that they blend and combine and culminate with the final approval of the annual budget. Any questions on the time?
No, I think we're good.
Moving on, then we establish a procedure for the annual initiative requests. So first, any new initiative may only be submitted by trustees, volunteer boards or committees or department heads to the village manager through the initiative form by March 1st. Upon submission, I would then assign a lead department to each request for review and further develop the initiative for consideration. Final request forms would be submitted back to me by the lead department by April 30th for compilation and review. Based on discussion with trustees, volunteer committees, and staff during the quarter two report, the board would prioritize initiatives for discussion within the annual budget process. The village board would then prioritize initiatives, and initiatives would be finalized and selected upon adoption of the annual budget. If selected, the lead department would work with the village manager to incorporate the initiative within their work plan as resources are available at the next available quarterly meeting. Initiatives not selected by the board may be requested in the following budget year.
Any questions on page two? Trustee McGovern?
Question about the form, like, is it Google?
Sure, we could put it on. Right now we have a PDF of the document that allows people to insert that. It's two pages on purpose. It's meant to provide a template to think through the framework of what's being proposed and the time and resources that may be allocated and how that spreads out over the course of the year. And I apologize, I did not provide that form here tonight, but happy to do so following the meeting.
I'm just, and then how would we sort of communicate the volunteer?
Well, one of the tools would be the policy itself and then communication through the staff liaisons. In essence, we do something very similar to this. The form is, I've used it in the past for village initiatives because sometimes they involve multiple groups. So it's a common sheet that keeps me on task, but then also is the single communication tool that we use among the partners. Because sometimes people have different ideas of or expectations. So that's something that can be visited then quarterly and updated or revised because conditions change. But it would be, you know, a form that would be submitted and then we could, you know, the staff liaison would work with the committee to process through this policy. But it's not this annual process of submitting an annual report and initiatives isn't new. We do it currently. But the initiative form gets more specific in terms of what's included within the unit.
Should this new policy pass, I would like to have a discussion about how we're going to rule to committee chairs and liaisons and just make sure that everyone, if there are any questions, address them in front of everybody at the same time. Mm-hmm. So that, you know, I mean, there are some committees that are obviously a little bit more active than other committees. But to the extent that we can, if we could get committee chairs with staff lead at even a Zoom meeting, okay, this is what this policy looks like, how we're going to implement. But you're going to need any perspective. I think that could go into making sure that everyone's on the same page.
I think that's a great idea.
If this passes.
Yeah, right. And I'd also welcome you guys to participate in the meeting. I think it's just helpful sometimes for them. A lot of people wear different hats, but yeah, I think that's great.
Do some of the committee heads or committees already know that this is in place, or this is kind of coming up, so they've had time to sort of prep? I'm sure January 31st seems like a long way, but it'll come up really fast for a lot of these committees. Are they aware that this is something that we're discussing and they should be kind of getting their sort of eggs in a basket right now, eggs in a row?
Well, we, as I said before, we have, for the last several years, have always documented the annual reports by the 31st and the initiatives. This policy formalizes that process, because I think the request that we're trying to meet is to provide a process that if we were not involved, someone else could pick up what we do and move forward with.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's important for a couple of reasons. Number one, you know, what we know about our group is that it's subject to change. So it's that helpful tool to kind of guide people. Number two, the same goes for our committees, right? So you'll have committees that ebb and flow. That's just the nature of them. And so it provides a helpful resource for any new chair, new staff liaison, you know, to document what we do. I think the largest change will be the requirement to submit that initiative form that clearly just outlines what's included within the initiative.
Got it. Thank you.
Any other questions about that?
And I guess just to follow up, committees are aware this policy is something that we're discussing right now?
I know that some people have inquired about it, so I've shared with them that we're going to be having discussions in December, primarily because the Village Board, if you'll recall, we had a list of initiatives that we were looking at, but our major ones were in flux and continue to be evolving for some of the largest projects that the Village Board is working on. So we deferred that. I'll be bringing those back to you to say, okay, here's what we approve within the scope of the budget and to re-verify that so that we schedule them accordingly within work plans.
Thank you.
Okay.
So So then we talk a little bit about task assignments that relates to project and activities that require less time and resources than an initiative, but go beyond what we perform for core services because they require dedicated staff and prioritized time to complete. These are not creating a new plan or process that requires multiple different groups to review and can be effectively handled with one person or a department head or a lead department without an impact to core service delivery. They're not required to be approved by the village board or directed by the village manager before they're placed into staff work plans. But upon selection, they can be placed into work plans on a quarterly basis in conjunction with a review of pre-existing projects. And here, any discrepancy between the interpretation of a village initiative versus a task assignment shall be determined by the village manager in consultation with the corresponding standing committee chair. So if it's a infrastructure project, I would be in conversation with Arthur because he's the chair of public works. If it was relative to community and business relations, I would be communicating with Eric Kudo. If it was with regards to strategic initiatives, Matt McGovern. That makes sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So only for task assignments, only a trustee may request that a task assignment be created through the submission of a future agenda item of consideration form, which is typically, it's what we do now on the agenda, but would have that form be submitted. If a volunteer board or a committee desires to have a project considered, they would need to work through a trustee to bring it forward to the board. Trustees should submit requests to the village manager for placement on the board agenda for future item of consideration. Task assignments would operate very similar to how we operate right now, which is under future items of consideration. It's not the time to discuss or evaluate the item, but merely for the board to say, you know, we're going to decline to work on this at this time, or we're going to approve to further discuss it. And then they would specify and refer it to a future village board standing committee or for further discussion by the board itself as scheduling and priorities permit, as determined by the village manager and the village board. So if you think about it, right now, when you guys have a future item of consideration, it goes on a list for me. And then depending on what time we have available for standing committees or the lead department's time available to prep for the item before you, then we slot it in the schedule and bring it forward. If denied, the task assignment just stops at that point.
Great. Thank you.
Any other questions? Should I'll say, I mean, I having worked with Rebecca on this back and forth for a little while, I think it was clear, at least from my perspective, that we needed to have an updated policy or process, right? That in the end, the buck stops with the board one way or the other. So whether we're talking about a village initiative or we're talking about a task assignment, MIDI should feel free to go directly to any one of us to help them, if it's a task assignment, bring that forward to the board in a sort of expedited manner, as long as it doesn't rock the entire boat, right? And it doesn't change our core services. The work plans and the village initiatives is a larger, sort of more standard process that we've used for a long time. What I really was worried about was about two things. One, committees feeling like they couldn't go to village trustees to have their concerns or to work on a project to say, hey, I want to do this here, I want to do that there, and that they had to go only through the village sort of bureaucracy itself. And two, that staff doesn't get inundated with requests and all these things from committees that frankly might not align with what we want to do at that point as a village board. And so this was sort of a way to massage both of them to make sure that in the end, things were still moving, things were still happening, that you could place things on agendas and you could move things forward, putting them through committees. With all of this, you know, using Robert's rules, you can fast track anything. None of that changes. You know, if something came up and it was an emergency, or we determined that it was so important it couldn't wait, we can fast track whatever we want to fast track whenever we want to do it. But this really sort of outlines for the committees what to expect, right? Because there are, I think, some misconceptions out there that, you know, everything should move a little bit quicker. It should be a little bit faster. And there's just so much that the staff's dealing with, that the board's dealing with, that we can't take up everything all at once. And I think this process doesn't, this policy outlines a nice way for us to address those concerns and work with committee members, members of the community, and village staff to put them in and slot them in appropriately when able, as long as it doesn't interfere with core services. So I appreciate this policy. I appreciated working on it, going back and forth. It's, you know, probably not perfect. We can fix it. We can change it. We can update it whenever we would like if we find that something doesn't work the way that we wanted it to, or something could work better. But for right now, you know, I think this is a really nice starting point. And as long as we get everyone, you know, the committee chairs on board, and we get the staff liaisons on board, and everyone understands roles and responsibilities clearly from the beginning, this hopefully should alleviate a lot of questions we have about why is this taking so long, or why isn't this getting taken up, or, you know, I sent it here and I haven't heard anything about it. This outlines what the process was, and there's a timeline attached. So I think that's very helpful. So that's all I have to say about that. Any other questions about policy?
None for me. I think it sounds great. Thank you for putting this together, Rebecca. And thank you for, you know, helping put this together.
Yeah, I think it makes sense.
Okay. Is there a motion attached?
No, I apologize. I listed it as review.
Okay.
But if amenable to the group, I'll provide it to the board at the meeting on December 16th with the information that there were no objections. And then if the board approves them, we'll move forward with implementation. But in advance, I'll reach out to the committee chairs to schedule a meeting just to get together either way, perhaps for January.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think there's a chance that, you know, we're going to hear from committee chairs about the policy beforehand. So, you know, if we could, I don't know if it's something to include in the manager's memo, or
would you like me to send it out to the committee chairs?
I think it would be wonderful that, like, hey, you know, this is past review in committee. This is what we're looking to present to the board on the 16th. Would love your thoughts. You know, and then again, if we get a ton of feedback and we think that this is going to require an additional community and business relations meeting where we have, you know, testimony from the community, fantastic. If not, it's fine as well. But at the, you know, that way they get another kick at the can. You know, other members of the other trustees have an opportunity to look at the policy, ask any additional questions that they might have, that, you know, this isn't sort of something that's brought up quickly and fast tracked tonight. Mm-hmm. That sounds perfect to me.
Okay, happy to do that.
As long as it works for both committee members.
Yep.
Okay.
All right.
With nothing else, nothing else. I know. I had a lisp that just showed up for the first time ever. With nothing else agendized for this evening, I would entertain a move to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Hey, we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None. We stand adjourned at 7:21 p.m.
Let me know. All right. It's 7:33. I'd like to call to order the regular meeting of the Sherwood Village Board. All trustees are in attendance. President McCaig is virtual and under the weather at the moment, and thus I am chairing the meeting in her stead and hoping that she's feeling better. Has the meeting been properly noticed according to law?
Yes.
Excellent. Next item is special order of business. We have one, the 2023 audit. How will we be handling this?
I'm looking, Christina Domer is on the call tonight, finance director, and I am presuming that Everett Eaton perhaps is with the firm. Christina?
Not sure who is joining tonight.
Yeah, I don't see anyone from Sikich on the line.
I don't either. I'm wondering if they think it's on the next meeting.
Well, seeing that they are not here to present, I would recommend that we move on.
Do you need?
Yes, that would be wonderful. Thank you.
Is there a motion to defer?
So moved. I move we defer the 2023 audit to the December 16 meeting.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Is this a roll call vote or just? Okay, excellent. All right. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. 7-0, move on. Next item is the consent agenda. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented?
Move to approve.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
I move to pull item B as in Betty.
Okay. Any others? All right. Okay, is there a motion to approve the consent agenda with the noted item removed?
The move.
Second.
All right. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right. Approved. Trustee Stokran.
Yeah, on the minutes, I just, for the public hearing on the budget, there was a vote, and under new business 10A, motion carried by a roll call vote of 4-2, it would be great to put the two dissenters in parentheses so the public knows. I believe it would be Kudo and McGovern. And with that, I would move to approve the minutes of November 18, 2024.
I'll second.
Okay. We have motion and second. Any discussion? All right. Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
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 All right. Motion passes. Next item. Next item is, okay, public hearing. There's no public hearing scheduled for the evening, which leads us to item 8, citizens to be heard. This is items for matters not on the agenda. Have we heard from any citizens to be heard? Pre-submitted questions or anything? No. Are there any questions from the audience? All right. Seeing none, we'll move on to the next item, new business. The first item, new business, is consider safe streets for all traffic calming demonstration, grant activities, and locations. Director Griepenchaug.
Good evening, everyone. I'd be happy to present a brief overview. So as indicated in the memo, this has been a grant opportunity outstanding since June of 2023. At that time, we were approached by Milwaukee County to rather quickly apply for the opportunity to receive money for demonstration activities. At that time, we didn't have the proper amount of time for public review of the proposed application. So I submitted on our behalf with respect to activities that were already identified in our existing bike ped plan and or our transportation and parking analysis. It took several months, over a year, for that agreement to actually be signed by the federal government and Milwaukee County before we could start proceeding with that. That was signed in September of this year, at which point I reached back out to the village engineers at Strand to confirm that they had no issues with the proposed installations. They did not. I also then went to the Parks and Public Spaces Committee to reiterate the plan that was presented in the application, to ask if they had any questions. There were no concerns that were voiced. I then also reached out to the North Shore Fire Department and Shorewood School District, since these will impact their operations both in front of the school and with just emergency apparatus, et cetera. They also had no concerns. So what is before you tonight is a proposal that would install up to 6 demonstration activities in the form of temporary traffic circles, temporary curb extensions, and temporary speed tables. The traffic circles would be installed on Murray Avenue, which has long been designated as a former bike boulevard, now to be known as a neighborhood greenway. The curb extensions would be on Kensington, west of Oakland, where we've had complaints and issues with people parking too close to crosswalks and blocking pedestrian visibility, particularly people going to the business district and or people going to the school. So just kind of opening up those intersections, daylighting them, as it's known to be called. And then installing temporary speed tables on the Morris Menlo cut through, where people, take Morris heading south to avoid the intersection of Kaplan Oakland. There'd be 2 places where we would install temporary speed tables. So that is what is within the packet tonight. I'm happy to answer any additional questions that you might have regarding either the locations or the installations themselves. We're projecting that we would be able to install them in spring of 2025 while school is still in session, so that we can test these out under normal conditions and just see how they work. If they in fact do work positively, we hope that we can either install additional temporary installations in the future and or make them permanent.
I have a question. These are designed to be, sort of demonstration projects, temporary infrastructure, something like a speed table. I was reading in the memo that they're made out of rubber. How long do those last?
I don't have full information on that. That'd probably be dependent upon which particular installation we pick. But they're not meant to be full time. The goal would be to test them out, make sure that there's no issues with respect to how they impact traffic and safety of the area, and then if desired, we would install them with permanent asphalt. So I would hope a couple years, but for the purpose of the demonstration grant, they'll be installed 4 to 6 weeks. We are required to remove the fixtures after the test has been completed, because it is specifically a temporary demonstration grant. And so, if we choose to reinstall them in the fall, I don't think there's issues with that, but we do have to test before, during, and after. And then yes, if they're in good enough condition, we could possibly reuse them in other locations.
Okay. Yeah. I would just add that speed tables have been shown to be really effective in slowing down traffic in particular areas. And I can't really think of a better place than that section of Morris. Traffic moves there really fast. And anyone in village government, I'm sure, has heard complaints from people that live on those couple of blocks there. Some people, longtime residents there, have been trying to get the village to do something for years and years and years. So I'm really happy to see. I know it's a lot of work to get anything from the federal government and get the county to sign off. So I just want to commend you, Director Griepentrog, and your staff for getting this done and persevering, turning $10,000 in village funds into $50,000 in federal funding to make our streets safer for pedestrians and bikes and cars as well. People driving cars, I think it's just great. So I'm looking forward to seeing some progress on this.
Trustee, you're saying?
I echo Trustee McGovern. This is a really great step, I think, in the right direction for Shorewood. And I look forward to seeing how the community and our traffic interact with these temporary installations. My one question is, have you had a chance to talk to Leanne about, or I should say DPW, about how this could affect any of the sort of vehicles and equipment that they have out there running through winter or other seasons?
Yeah, I neglected to say that both Director Butchlick and Chief Worth were involved with the relatively recent conversation. So internally, we had a meeting with the village engineer, DPW, and the police department, And we all look forward to testing these out and seeing if they work. But yeah, there are, you know, definite concerns on how they would impact with snow operations. So we're installing them after that. We wouldn't want to put temporary stuff out where a plow might hit it. So we're hoping, you know, April, May will be safe of that. But yes, Chief Worth and Director Bushlick were both involved with the recent discussions.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Trustee Kudo.
Hey, Bart, this is Trustee Kudo. Just as a matter of curiosity, the placement of this, I agree with everything that Trustee Ersing and Trustee McGovern have said. I think these are wonderful. I am very clearly not an expert in traffic flow. But I'm wondering the locations, having now dropped off my daughters at SIS far too many times in the last year and a half, it would seem to me that having them a little bit farther south on Morris might make a little bit more sense looking at the traffic flow as opposed to having them right off, having that one at least right off of Capitol Drive. Is there a reason you put them there as opposed to anywhere else on that boulevard?
I am also not a traffic engineer. That is what the village engineer at Strand recommended. I believe the rationale was wanting to make it known to people who turn right away that they know they're entering a slower area. So that first one just north of Pinedale, I think is seen as it's far enough away from the intersection that it won't impact operations within the intersection, but still close enough that people are warned pretty early on that they need to take this path slowly. And then I do believe they mentioned that it's best to have them in succession and not superly spread out. Mm-hmm. And so it was their recommendation to have them on the Morris leg of the Morris Menlo cut through. And quite honestly, we have to place them where there are not driveways. And there are a lot of driveways on the intersection. So finding places where they can actually fit, I think the first one is easily understood. The second one might quite honestly be a matter of where driveways do not impact the placement with the logic of having it be relatively close in succession.
Okay, that makes perfect sense. So thank you for the clarification.
Sure.
Trustee Stokenbrand.
So first of all, thank you, staff. And I feel like we should throw a party. Are these going to be the first traffic circles we've ever had in Shorewood?
To my knowledge, unless there were some historic ones out there that were removed at some point. But yeah, to my knowledge, these would be.
And the first speed tables, right?
Correct.
Ooh, party time, battalion style. Okay. Question about the curb extensions on Kensington. So at each intersection, obviously there's like northwest, southwest. You know what I'm saying? Would you put them around, like would there be four at each intersection? Or would it just be, you know what I'm saying? Like, would it just be on the east side of that intersection?
I believe it would just be on the north and south sides of Kensington. It would not be in the street of Bartlett and Newhall. I could be wrong on that. Once again, Strand is designing them. But the intention was to help people crossing Kensington and to increase the visibility of that particular stretch of the roadway. But if it's their advice or logic that all sections of every crosswalk should be shortened, I would defer to them. But the intention definitely has been that cars are parking too close to the intersection on Kensington so that you can't see if there's a pedestrian in that crosswalk. So having these curb extension posts there would prohibit a car from parking there better than a no parking sign ever would. And therefore daylight the intersection so that people could see pedestrians attempting to cross Kensington. I don't believe that Newhall and Bartlett were shown to be problematic, but once again, I would defer to them. And if you have thoughts on whether or not you'd like to see that, I could definitely, you know, make that known to them. It's just be a matter of, you know, purchasing additional posts.
Right. That was my point, was it would double the price, right?
You would be doubling the amount of posts that you would need for those intersections.
And I guess I was also curious about, we're supposed to pay for the speed data, traffic counting, traffic tracking equipment. So we don't have it, obviously, or Strand doesn't have it, or we're supposed to buy new. or do you rent?
At the time of grant application, I relied heavily on Wauwatosa, who has in-house engineering services, because I didn't want to incur costs from Strand. But that was the expectation, that most communities would either be purchasing it or renting it. I can confirm whether, if Strand has it, then we would not need to be doing either. We would probably be paying for their service, obviously, but it was their expectation and other communities' expectations that you'd be likely be renting or purchasing it, and then reviewing the data, from that. Because we at the village do not have that specifically, but if Strand has it, all the better. But I do not know that offhand. I would be confirming that with them. And if we can save money anywhere, that'd be great.
Right. Because I mean, my guess is they have a traffic engineer. They must have equipment, but that'd be great. So really looking forward to this. And I'm guessing, obviously, part of the data will be speeds by the speed tables. And do they also, obviously, would use it for the traffic circle too, but the data for the curb extensions, there's really no way to measure that.
I believe Strand discussed just visual, being able to take photos and qualitatively to show, the amount of distance that can be seen at, 10 feet away, 30 feet away, et cetera. So yeah, it might not be quantity or speed, but it might be qualitative in terms of what a difference the installation does to the look and feel of the roadway.
And then we get to keep the pieces that we buy, the speed tables and the bollards. So even though the grant will end the demonstration, Public Works is prepared to store this stuff for future use, right?
Correct. Either store, or if it's not in good shape, we would discard. But if it's worth reusing, I would hope that we could find a place for that to be kept for future use.
Thank you.
I appreciate everything you're on this. I think everybody did a really good job with this. I just have one question to ask. So I live on Kensington and Marlboro, and my kids go to Lake Bluff, and my in-laws live on Newhall and Kensington. And so when we walk to school, we go to that exact intersection at Kensington and Newhall and go into the school. With regards to the curb extensions that are on Bartlett and Kensington and Newhall and Kensington, I have one concern with the one that's at Newhall and Kensington. That intersection already has a stop sign. I don't know if that impacted why they chose that one, if they wanted to have one on an intersection that had a stop sign or something like that. If I were choosing where to put one, I would like to see it on Bartlett and Kensington, and then Larkin and Kensington, because both of those streets are unmarked intersections. They have crosswalks though, and kids take those to and from school and to and from the park for practices and things like that. Especially that one on Larkin, drivers never know to stop there, and kids are always waiting to cross there every single morning, and after school as well throughout the night as they come back from practices and things like that. So the one on Newhall I think would be less needed from a traffic or from a pedestrian safety standpoint, since there is that existing stop sign there. And I'd rather see that one move to Larkin if that's possible. Unless, like I said, they're trying to collect some sort of information about having one on a stop sign.
No, I don't believe so. I think your local knowledge is well appreciated and received. The logic behind Bartlett and Newhall were both that cars going, or people parking to go to Oakland, park up those intersections, and we've received requests or complaints about wanting to free up those intersections. But to the point of there being a control at Newhall, I would have zero opposition to extending it to Larkin. The logic once again was just that more cars are likely to be parked at Newhall than Larkin that are going to the business district.
And that's true, especially Bartlett. Bartlett is really crowded. So, I mean, I'm glad to see it at Bartlett. I just think unless there's objection from anybody here.
If I remember correctly, that Bartlett's the only intersection with a crossing guard.
And it's also the only one with a crossing guard on that side, okay. Correct? Yeah. And I think it's definitely a crossing guard is definitely necessary at Bartlett. The bump outs will be necessary at Bartlett. Newhall, I just think it'd be slightly safer. I mean, not a huge deal, but slightly safer at Larkin, since kids do cross there. There's no crossing guard and there's no stop sign. So I mean, it'd be nice to have something there.
Yeah, I would favor that.
If we have enough money, could we do all three?
We could. We sent the grant application that we submitted had these types of infrastructure, so circles, extensions, and speed tables, and the amount and placement were pretty much dependent on cost. And so, you know, if we get estimates back that we can add a third one, I'd have zero opposition, or, you know, at least placing Newhall behind Larkin, if that's a consensus of the group. Once again, I appreciate the local knowledge on that. That's probably just an oversight on our part, based on the logic of closer to Oakland was what was discussed, not necessarily in respect to traffic control or not.
Or if you're only putting them on the Kensington Boulevard on the north and south sides, you know, and not on the north-south ones, then maybe you would have enough. It just depends on how your numbers come in, right?
Right.
Yeah, I would see far less need for an east-west. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nobody's going through, right. Especially Newhall's a dead end.
So, I mean, Bart, I guess, at least what I'm saying is that if they were planning on doing four corners, if we could split it and just do north-south,
yep.
And that gets us more coverage in other intersections, I would absolutely be in favor of that.
Yep, I appreciate that. That makes sense.
And I would just say, you know, if none of that's possible and it ends up like this, this is still a good thing. It'd be nice to throw something on Larkin, because like I said, they're definitely there crossing every day.
Trustee Rusinkti, do you have anything to add?
Well, I'm in total favor of those ideas, suggestions.
Okay. President McKeag?
Sorry, I support that.
Okay.
I will say that, you know, as I live on North Morris, and, you know, I find that street to be fairly dangerous. A lot of kids constantly traveling Morris to get to SIS in the high school. I'm not sure what can be done. I know we have two bump outs south on Morris, but North Morris, there's a bit of a turnaround from Culver's there. A lot of heavy traffic, a lot of speeding traffic from that intersection on Olive. There's no stopping from Olive and Morris all the way to Capitol. So people tend to go pretty fast in that little jaunt right there. A lot of young families live on that block. And, you know, from the time I've lived there till now, it's always been fairly dangerous. Would love to see something happen there, but I don't think I'm in a position to lobby for something right now, right there. But that intersection, and I know it's a thoroughfare, it's a thoroughway for emergency vehicles, but that is, it's a highly trafficked area. A lot of kids use that to go to school. And I feel it's fairly dangerous with the speeds and, you know, a lot of reckless driving from a Culver's perspective, that turnaround right there from that green arrow that people get on Capitol. Would love for somebody to look into that. We always thought something would be appropriate and that little nook from Olive to Capitol on Morris. But, you know, again, I don't think we're in a position right now to lobby for that, but would love to have somebody consider that at some point.
Yeah, I totally agree. Where Kenmore dead ends into Morris, having grown up in that intersection,
yep.
It's been a problem for a very, very long time. So again, if there were opportunities, I would certainly be in favor of trying to slow down traffic on Morris, especially because it's probably the busiest street we have.
Yeah.
So it would help in many, many, many.
Well, kids too. I mean, it's all day. It's a stream of kids coming to school. It's a stream of kids coming home, and then yep. Sports activities. You see kids biking on Morris in that nook. Just constantly summer. It's a high traffic pedestrian area that also sees a lot of sort of reckless driving from the traffic from the business district or at least from Culver's. So. Just to keep that as a note, Bart, I'm not sure what we can do about it, but it is sort of it is a real hot spot, and to see two sort of speed tables or speed humps on South Morris, but not one sort of North Morris, you know, I kind of question that a little bit, but I think having two by a school, it could definitely help in that neighborhood. But I do feel like North Morris could also use a little bit of attention as well.
Definitely noted, and I do hope that we can have opportunity for additional installations in the future.
Thank you.
Are you ready for a motion?
Yeah, I just wanted to add that, yeah, I really appreciate all the work you and the team did in bringing this forward. Bart, you know, I think when you laid out the options at the outset, they all made a lot of sense to me. And that was definitely, you know, reinforced in talking to, you know, residents on that stretch of Morris that we're addressing now. You know, I heard a lot from residents there and also heard a lot from residents on Kensington about some of the issues and congestion there. So I think these will be, you know, all well, you know, all well taken as we move forward. And yeah, again, as you know, we heard from the group, I think we have a big opportunity now that we've kind of built this base of knowledge, you know, and continue to build the space of knowledge, we can look at how we can apply our, you know, learnings elsewhere. So just hopefully it'll be a beginning and not an end. So I guess the one question I did have is in term, assuming, you know, all this checks out and, you know, these are, you know, make an impact and, you know, we want to make these permanent, with the installation of permanent safety features be like worked into the street reconstructions, or would that be built into the street reconstruction schedule for those streets? So like the next time they do that stretch of Morris, they would put these in, or how would that work out?
Yeah, that would be the hope or expectation, if not sooner, but definitely at the time of reconstruction, if these are shown to be successful, they would definitely be, you know, worked in that plan. I've discussed that with Director Butchlick and she agrees that it would make sense. So we do have opportunities with respect to, you know, replacing water mains and stuff that will impact roadways. So getting the data, the buy-in on these things as useful pieces of infrastructure, definitely I do expect to be worked into future capital improvements.
Awesome. Okay. Thank you. Trustee Stokeman?
Before I make a motion, I guess I was hoping that if we found that these were effective and accepted by the community, if not embraced by the community, that we would do these on our own, perhaps in 2026, and we look at these as part of our 2025 review of pedestrian safety. That we wouldn't wait for, you know, a water main to need to be replaced, that we could do them sooner.
Yeah, I'd have no opposition to reviewing the data once the study's done and getting further direction on how the board would like to proceed. Obviously, it would require budgetary allocation. So definitely, I'd be happy to, I will, either whether you want to or not, but I will bring the results of the study back to the board so that you can, you know, provide further direction on how you'd like to see them either temporary or permanently installed. The point I was just making was, you know, when we do in infrastructure projects, I do hope that these become more normalized in terms of thinking about what options do we have with the projects that we're working on.
Thank you. Ready?
Yeah.
I move to approve the proposed Safe Streets for All Traffic Calming demonstration grant activities and locations as presented, but prioritizing Larkin and Kensington for curb extensions over Newhall and Kensington.
Second.
And just so you guys know, if you want him to consider the points that you made about potentially breaking up the different areas, you might want to add a caveat for that to the motion. If you don't want him to consider it, I would.
North, south, first, east, west. I think. Yeah.
Just to make it a little bit more.
We say something along the lines of and preference north, south, curb extensions to maximize. The ones that face the north east and west. South. Yeah, I know what you're talking about. You're talking about going east and west.
It could even be as basic as with direction to take into consideration the points made by the board.
I think that would be keep it at that level versus specificity.
I like that route.
It could be that simple.
I'll try again.
Okay.
I move to approve the proposed Safe Streets for All Traffic Calming demonstration grant activities and locations as presented, but prioritizing Larkin and Kensington for curb extensions over Newhall and Kensington with staff discretion regarding prioritization of north south streets.
North south extension.
north-south extension.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
Director Greenberg, does that all make sense?
Yes.
You correct. Do all yep. this good job interpreting our words. Thank you.
All right. Any questions or comments from the public on this one? All right. Seeing none, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All right. 7-0 approved.
As a matter of curiosity, how are we telling the public about this? Are they just going to wake up one day and see them, or is it going out in a memo, or how? Especially the folks that live near there. Is there any plan to?
We did discuss internally when the designs are confirmed and we know exactly which ones we would be doing, that we would send a neighborhood notice, at least to the street, the residents in the street where it's impacted. But until we know exactly budgetary wise which ones we were doing, and it would be nice to send plans with it as well. So we would hope, by January, we would have a more direct handle on exactly which ones and where. So it was our plan to send letters to the impacted streets.
Can I just request that, and this doesn't have to be part of the motion, but if that happens, that we all get that, but we can send it on to folks as well, or it's put the village manager's memo. Or...
Yeah, I'd like to feature it, if at all.
That would be...
Just because I think it's helpful, and we haven't discussed this so far, I'm sorry if I'm getting ahead of it, but I think it'd be helpful for, you know, that ramp up to be put out in those, and then to also provide a vehicle so that they can submit communication back, so we're collecting it all in one space.
Okay. I mean, I guess the easiest way for me to put it is I would like to see a communication plan included in the final plan for this agenda.
I'd be happy to do that. Yep.
Thank you.
All right. Moving on to new business item B, consider 2025 meeting dates.
Included in your packet was a list of village board meeting dates. One change from prior years is that typically when a holiday has fallen on a Monday, the meeting defers to Tuesday. The court usually meets on Tuesday, and so then the court gets bounced over to Village Center, and it's just logistically, we're requesting that the board meet on a Wednesday if that's the case. So there are two dates in which that occur, the first being on Wednesday, January 22nd, and the second being on Wednesday, September 3rd. It should also be noted that in conjunction with how we ran the budget process this year, when it says special budget and finance committee meeting, there was a concerted effort to move forward with committee of the whole and inclusive of the entire board, given the amount of content and evaluation that we're doing on certain items. So I will be updating that after this meeting. But again, this is a fluid schedule, but these dates have moved in conjunction with how the board has advised them before in the past. And so just request a motion of approval.
Let me just consult my congressional calendar that I just got in the mail before I...
Okay.
Trustee Stokebrand.
I just had a couple of questions. Some places it puts when offices are closed, and other places it doesn't. It would just be helpful if it would be consistent. Something else I noticed, I think, excuse me, we have Passover Sunday, April 12th. I think that's but we don't have Easter is Sunday, April 20th. We correct the date for would yes we correct the date to Saturday for Passover and insert Easter Sunday.
Sure. And the Passover date is Saturday, you said?
I believe.
Questions from other trustees?
I'd like to move to approve.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? I guess just one question I had. Does this, in terms of the budgeting schedule, does this track with what we did this past year, or
Yes.
Same. Okay. All right. Is there any option or ability to, you know, move any, based on the capacity of the finance director, to move any of those discussions up earlier or find time to work that in?
Move the budget process up earlier?
Or, yeah.
I would need to consult with LNA on it, but I don't know. That process sticks, we close quarter two, so those are, like, from a practical standpoint, you need at least that 6 month quarter closure of the year to then recalibrate for submission of budget.
Mm-hmm.
I think, are you thinking of maybe like more specific items related to the budget that aren't, that are policy based versus not? I want to get a better understanding.
Yeah, well, I guess, you know, we'll have a big, I mean, obviously we had a big ask on the budget this year. Next year's budget, you know, we'll continue to have some larger, you know, questions, you know, perhaps around service levels, things of that nature. So I'm just wondering if there's an opportunity to think about moving up, you know, have, being able to engage on some of those topics earlier than we currently
okay.
do.
Okay, so that would be different than just like the stand to me, when,
right?
Because right,
right.
Very tactical working right. through the budget process. That's something that you're going to be working on all year. So we're going to continue with the Let's Talk series of public information. And is this with regards to your email today?
Right.
Okay. So I think my suggestion for that would be to lay out what that communication plan looks at like based upon budget outlook, so that we can engage earlier and continue gaining feedback along the way as we move forward into the next budget season.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah, I guess my concern is if we come into the long range financial meeting on Monday, April 28th, if staff has it pretty much set up, I just would like to know that we have the opportunity for a lot more input in that meeting so that we're not surprised, you know, at big levers again. That was a challenge. And so we need to know as soon as possible. I understand you're saying, like, we have to be farther along in the year, in the fiscal year, to be able to project, but there are a lot of these big things that we have already committed to and are in the process of committing to, for example, with public works. So I guess I would like to know, for example, I like also the idea of considering parking meters. And so before we look at that long range financial plan review on April 8th, I would hope that we would have looked at all the financial items that would go into that schedule. Things like, when will the streetlight fee take effect? When will we see the revenue from the wheel tax? If we did parking meters, how soon could we see that revenue? I think it would help me be able to sit in that meeting on April 28th to have had that discussion already.
So I'm going to get us back on track a little bit. Okay. There is a motion pending right now to approve the dates. If you guys want to talk about details about the financial meeting, that's great, but I think that needs to be a future item because it's not noticed right now.
All right, we have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? All right. Next item, report of village officials, starting with the village president.
No report, unless Trustee McGovern, if you want to fill in on the lead lateral ICC item.
Yeah, I'm going to draft up a resolution for the next meeting, which I believe is December 12th, and that's the resolution will just be for the other communities in Milwaukee County to make the same requests that we made for assistance from the state with lead laterals and water mains, since that's such a big budget item and there's a $4.3 billion surplus that the state has right now. It'll be more powerful coming from, you know, other communities besides Shorewood. So that's something we're working on.
All right. Report from other village trustees. Trustee Stoke Brown.
First of all, I want to thank the police department and village manager Ewald for putting the calls on the manager's memo. I think that's helpful, and it shows some of the work that they're doing that we sometimes forget about. I also wanted to thank Public Works. I attended the lead service line meeting. I think it was well attended, about at least a dozen people, and there were three people from the Public Works Department there answering questions, so that was really helpful. And I also did want to mention that December 12th is the meeting for input on the final draft of the bike and ped safety update, and also some updates on the comprehensive parks plan, but I don't think that's a final situation. So that's December 12th.
Any other reports? All right. I'm moving on to reports from the village manager.
You have the quarter three initiative and up plan and work plan update in your packet. Notable or just updates are in red. And I can questions relative to that. Otherwise, I wanted to just let everyone know that we did meet for the candidate forum over at the library just prior to our and we had a good turnout for school board members. So there's some good information. And I want to thank Stokebrand and Udo for staying and McGovern for attending to represent the village.
All right, next item is future items of consideration.
Chair.
I had a question about some of the planning. I just wanted to be clear. I noticed on the quarter one department work plan, it actually has a December 2024 date. So Capital Drive Tapper request recommendations, that will be at the December 16th meeting. Is that on page 200 of the packet? Five items from the bottom.
And you said it's in the planning and development section?
Public Works,
or okay.
Quarter one department work plans, but then it talks about a Public Works Committee December 2024, so that would be in 2 weeks. That, because I would let the committee know if that's the I can ped safety.
No, I don't believe that that's accurate. I can confer with Leanne, but I'm wondering if that was a typo.
Okay. You can let me know, and then I'll let them know. And then the other thing I was noticing in the village manager's office review of funding large capital assets, I guess that sort of gets into what we were talking before about, you know, looking for input sooner on these large pieces, spending as well as, you know, expenditures and revenue both. So if there's any way that I or other business and finance members or anybody, we could be involved in that a little bit to know what you're looking at for rethinking how we do those. But that's the spending side. The revenue side is the other one. And I final question, execute Brews Committee. There's a committee I don't know about. Am I not invited to the Brews Committee? BREWS?
It is. It's actually a staff committee focused around how we do activities together and benefits, a circulation of things. So it's
not on a brew act.
Well, I have to tell you, I apologize, but I forget what it stands for.
I think I have an idea.
Yeah.
Well, I know it's not that.
Oh, okay. Well, then I don't want on that committee.
Thank you.
All right. Next item, future items of consideration. We're agendaed for one item. Consider utilization of TID 1 extension funds for infrastructure improvements to improve the housing stock.
I'll go. So this was something that I became aware of at the Wisconsin League of Municipalities convention. There was a workshop on making the most of your TID. And it became apparent that you could use 25% of your TID money for improving housing stock, which includes things like streetlights and water mains. I guess I had an impression that it had to be for things like energy efficiency, new windows, new roofs, insulation, or something like that. But we could use some of this if we're looking for a piece next year to help us work with the tax levy limit, with our tax levy situation. This could be a piece that would give us some flexibility. So that's why I moved forward.
Would it be in the, would it apply to the whole village or just things like streetlights and water mains in the TIF district?
It sounded like it could be village-wide. There was a gentleman from Baird, and I can find his name and phone number and stuff, but it was my understanding that it could be used village-wide, like a TID, you know. So it would give us some flexibility, so obviously $2 million, it would be $500,000. And that would move the needle on some tax levy increase for 2026.
I'd be in favor of seeing that.
Yeah, same here.
Yeah, I'd like more information. I'd like to see like what kind of the limitations are in that. But I mean, because it almost sounds too good to be true. But I would like to see some more research on that.
And I guess the important thing is being able to understand financially. You know, if it saves you from taking out $500,000 debt over 20 years. You know, at 5%, that's another $500,000.
Yeah.
But otherwise, if you just put it towards your cash flow, it would affect your levy increase here. So I thought it was worth discussing and learning about.
Thank you, Kathy, for attending and finding this information. This is great.
Yep. So is the item then to explore the feasibility and options of pursuing this path then? Is that the kind of trajectory you're on with this?
Right.
Okay. Yeah. No, I mean, I think I echo everyone else and thinking it definitely makes sense as some of them look at, like, Trustee Lynn, I'd like some more information, just better understand like how we get more bang for the buck, you know, because if you know, this doesn't make sense.
Obviously the downside is you would have less available.
Correct. So, right. And so what's, you know, and I think we really need to understand those trade-offs before we would do anything.
So this information was discussed with an extension of TID fund and with the CDA in past meetings. So I appreciate the suggestion. It's something that you've always had consideration for. It's truly just a policy decision of the board, but I think it would be helpful for the board if you are looking to use it, that you had that communication point with the CDA, because it just decreases the amount in the fund. How you choose to use it is really up to the board. So I'm happy to compile the prior information we've provided on the Tidwater Extension funds in the past, and then you can take it up at a future meeting. Or because my next question would be like, well, where would this go next? But it would truly just be a board decision.
Well, the question, would it go to budget and finance first?
Yeah.
If they would want to provide a recommendation to the board, sure.
Okay.
That would be my preference. Go to budget and finance, and then should they determine that it's something we want to explore, then the village board determines it's something we want to explore. Then we would discuss it with CDA. It's premature before that, since we're ultimately the body that's responsible for determining where those appropriations go.
I just need a motion.
Any other questions or comments from members of the board?
I mean, I'm still not really clear what we'd be voting on. Is this just for the committee to look at?
Right. I would hope that staff could provide some information about how much this could affect our budget for 2020. What would happen? How does it happen? Would we pass a motion? Obviously, you can go up. I think you can go up to 25%. So you could choose to do a little less. I mean, would it get to be to the sort of thing where we get to the budget next year and like the parking situation? Like we're looking at 6%, but we could make it 5.5% if we took something out of the TID money, assuming it's still there and we haven't spent it in 5. You see what I'm saying? I would just like to know
how
late in the budget process could we decide if we wanted to do this, if we wanted to do it, first of all, what are the legal ramifications of doing it? And how late in the year? I'm not eager to spend money that we, you know, but I would like to know that it's there and how much we could, we can use up to 25%, but you wouldn't have to use all of the 20% as money. And so it would give us some flexibility.
Oh, got it. President McKay.
Thank you. I'd like it to go be a committee of the whole discussion item, since it involves a lot of technicalities.
Is that a motion?
Not yet.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm trying to type in.
No, so I guess that was the thing. So
I just didn't know.
I mean, Kathy or someone else, would you like to make a motion then?
I mean,
Trustee Kudo?
Sure. I understand why President McKay wants it to go to committee of the whole. I would prefer, frankly, that the committee that's responsible for this take a look at it before we all sit down and take a look at it to see if it's even feasible. So I would move to send this to Budget and Finance, and I would move that Budget and Finance consider the utilization of TID 1 extension funds for infrastructure improvements to improve the housing stock.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All right, seeing none, all in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Aye.
All opposed?
Nay.
6-1, motion passes. Next item. Takes us into closed session.
All right. I move that the village board adjourn the meeting in closed session pursuant to 19.851E to discuss negotiating strategy for the police union agreement.
Again.
All right. It's a roll call, I think.
Correct. Trustee Lynn?
Aye.
Trustee Kudo?
Aye.
I'm sorry. Trustee Stokefried?
Aye.
Went too fast. Trustee Arndorfer?
Aye.
Trustee Ursink?
Aye.
Trustee McGovern?
Aye.
The meeting adjourns into closed session
McKay.
At
aye.
President McKaig?
Aye.
Now the meeting will adjourn into closed session at 8:26 p.m. For those individuals on the call, we're going to be moving into a breakout room for purposes of closed session. And we have no action items listed following reconvening into open session.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Seeing none. All in favor of adjourning?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you.